Hello everybody and welcome to another Manga Thoughts and Opinions video. Disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers can help to give you a clearer image of the style of video discussion that I do for this series. Dude, I fucked that up, didn't I? Whatever, I don't care. I'm moving on. Anyways, greetings again. This is being recorded just after finishing up on my ReZero Volume 6 for Chapter 3 Truth of Zero video, which will be released probably on the 12th of November. This is also being recorded on the 12th of November, but this video is probably not going to be going out until probably tomorrow, the 13th of November, or some following day. I don't know. So yeah, Volume 7 of ReZero, Starting Life in Another World, Chapter 3, Truth of Zero. You'll have to forgive the quality of the image that is being used for this video's theme. I couldn't get a clear, sizable image of the Volume 7 book cover without the Amazon, "This is not the final cover," mark on it, so I had to upscale using AI, and you can definitely see that the AI struggled a little bit. But it is what it is, I suppose. It'll have to get the job done. Not like anyone's watching these as opposed to listening to them anyways. Okay, Volume 7. So I'm not going to go through all of the stuff I said about in my Volume 6 video, that this was something I had basically started and was only going to read a chapter or two, but ended up finishing, and now I have two videos to do. Now I only have one because I've done the Volume 6 video. So I guess without further ado, we can go ahead and get right into it. There's no real other explanations to be given. But like I said in my Volume 6 video, chances are the Volume 7 video is going to be shorter than that, probably less than 40 minutes, simply because while this isn't a short book per se, most of the stuff to talk about is just, oh, they're fighting, you know, and this is what happens in the fighting. But there is some substantial stuff, backstory with one of the characters that we get in this volume as well. But I'll just do my best, I suppose. Okay, so this volume has 5 chapters in total, just like Volume 6, plus an afterword. And Chapter 1, Episode 28, which is titled "A Gamble to Defy Despair." Now, I had a bite to eat earlier. I had some dinner right before I sat down to do the video for Volume 6, and my stomach feels empty. And I don't know if that means I'm going to throw up or that I'm still hungry. So I don't know. Just as a fair warning, in case something very awkward happens during this video. Alright, so Chapter 1 here is actually an extremely short chapter. It's only like a few pages long. But this chapter, pretty much the only notable stuff that kind of happens in this chapter, we got something funny from Rem, which I quite appreciate. And we also learn a few other things. So we get Krush encouraging everyone to get back on their feet, because everyone's kind of tattered and beaten from this whale fight, and now there's 3 whales, you know, so everyone's losing faith. But Subaru and Rem, specifically Subaru, is out there in the field. He's weak, he has no weapons, he has no special abilities, you know, he's just some dude with a buttload of determination. And so Krush uses that as a means to encourage everyone else to get back on their feet, which works. We also learn that Ricardo survived. So he did not perish. That was one of the things that we were left with at the end of the previous volume. That was one of the cliffhanger things. There is a pretty amusing line from Rem here, where because Subaru is giving off that nasty witch scent, the whale is attracted to him, and Rem says, "Sniffing Subaru's scent is a Rem-only privilege." Of course, I am... Okay, well, whatever. Sniffing is very important to me personally, so I'm happy that Rem is totally okay with that. Okay, so the only other notable thing we really get in Chapter 1 before it ends is that of the 3 whales, 2 of the whales, they're not fakes, but instead the primary whale, the white whale itself, basically split its power, divided its power up into 2 other versions of itself. So the only reason that Subaru learns this is, I believe, because Ricardo survived, the blow that he took was much lighter than it would have normally been if the whale had full power, which leads Subaru to deduce that, okay, so these whales, the whale has split itself, and now you have 3 less powerful whales as opposed to 1 primarily powerful whale. And he also figures it out because way up in the sky we have one whale just kind of floating around not doing anything, while the other two are down here fighting on the ground, on ground level. So the command whale is basically overwatching the battlefield from above, from safety. Okay, I gotta turn my page of my notes here. So chapter 2, episode 29, The Truth Behind the Rampage. Let's see. Okay, so again, like I said, this is like a kind of an awkward one to talk about because there's not a lot to talk about here. It's mostly just bunches of panels of them fighting. Everyone's getting involved, like everyone's getting involved. All the side characters, all the background characters, they're, you know, everyone's getting involved in some way in the battle. Wilhem, a previous character that was left at the end of the previous volume as being a cliffhanger of did he die, since he was eaten alive. Golden rule number one for me is if you never see a character die on screen, or in this case on page, I guess, chances are they have survived. Unless you're watching JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, where you can watch someone die on screen, but for some reason they're still alive again anyways. And I'm sure there's some other shows. I've heard rumors. I've never watched Naruto in its fullest, but I've heard rumors that Naruto does this type of thing a lot as well. But some year, some century, I'll actually get around to finishing that show. Anywho, yes, Wilhem survives. He basically pries himself out of the wet, fleshy whale. And that's a good thing, though I would say he definitely got his time to shine of badassery before dying, so I would have been pleasantly happy with his storyline, but he didn't get to avenge his wife, which is to defeat the white whale, and we'll even learn shortly that there's more to it than just avenging his wife, but to fulfill a sort of promise that he had made to himself as well, which kind of is a bit emotional, but okay, let's see. Right, okay, so the chapter closes with Rem summoning via her magic one of her big crystals. I don't know if it's ice magic, I don't remember. I'm pretty sure they actually explain this in the story at one point, what her magic is, but she creates this massive crystal and just tosses it at the whale, and everyone's watching like, holy shit, this thing's gonna delete the whale, but it misses. But that was intentional, because we get to see that Subaru is actually riding that crystal, and he rode it all the way up onto the whale, because he has a master plan on how to take this guy down, this giant white whale. We have to remember that Subaru has some sort of ability that was provided to him by the witch of... I'm trying to remember which witch. The Satella witch, right? I'm pretty sure that's what's been heavily implied here. Though I don't remember what she is. Is she... Oh, shoot, now I gotta check. Alright, I don't know. I couldn't tell you. I wanted to say the Witch of Jealousy, but the internet tells me Witch of Envy, and the internet also tells me that I have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about. Probably because the story of ReZero that I've experienced so far does not really give you very much on the witches yet. We get to see them in Season 2... We get to see most of the witches introduced, and we get to learn a little bit about each of them, but you don't really get to learn about them, if that makes any sense, right? You just get to kind of, you're introduced to them, you learn a little bit of their personalities and stuff. But regardless, anyways, he has this disgusting scent of the witch on him, so mob beasts are attracted to him. This has already been established in the story. Now, he actually uses this to his advantage multiple times throughout the battle with the white whale. In fact, it even happens once in Volume 6. I didn't talk about it there, but when he attempts to use his return by death statement out loud, you know, which is a big no-no apparently by whoever is grasping his heart inside, this attracts the beasties when he does this, because it kind of seeps all of this scent out of him, this essence. But in Volume 6, when he uses this, some character is breathing down his neck stating, "I love you." You don't get to know who it is. I think I kind of spoiled that already, but you don't get to know who that is yet. But it happens again two more times throughout Volume 7 when he uses this ability as well. He falls off the whale, which is presumably part of the plan, and Subaru uses his return by death trick to attract the whale to him. We once again see this mysterious character, presumably the witch, is breathing down his neck saying, "I love you." And then, of course, we get this really freaking awesome scene where Rem catches Subaru, pulls him onto the land dragon, and they are now being chased at point blank range. This whale is trying to gobble them up from behind, and we get this incredibly awesome scene, another really badassly drawn scene here, just like we talked about some scenes in volume 6, of them running up to Krush next to the tree or near the tree, and she's just standing there full stance with the sword down in the ground. It just firm look on her face, awesome. And then they run by her, and just the panels of this, of seeing them both run, she's standing there and they run past, and you get these perspectives of both of them. I don't know, total, she comes off as a total badass. There's a lot of badasses in ReZero. I think that's what we're coming to learn here. But great scene, really love the way that it was drawn. And then we see exactly how this plan is coming together, as she orders the Flugel tree, this giant, massive, huge tree, to be blown in half by the mage cannons, the magical, like, artillery or whatever that's being used, and it basically saws the tree in half at the base, and the tree then collapses. I'd say that the coordination here had to have been perfect. Either that or they were just hoping, because the tree, this huge tree that is stories and stories and stories and stories tall, falls down right on top of the white whale as it passes below and crushes it, trapping it beneath this huge tree trunk. And it just works. It just works. And that chapter ends, bringing us to chapter 4. It ends with, I should specify that it actually ends with Wilhem walking up to the whale, basically saying that, you know what, now, for my wife, you shall perish. And we then come to chapter 4, which is episode 31, Wilhem von Astrea, whatever. This is where we get to learn a little bit of backstory about Wilhem. This is, I would say, the meat and bone of volume 7. This is where you're going to get most of the, like, story-related stuff. It's not just all combat. Because the reason why this discussion is probably going to be much shorter, like I said, is because most all of the pages are just them fighting the whale. They're like action scenes. And they're really fun to read, but there's not really much to talk about, except scenes like when they pass by Krush. You know, I can talk about, oh, I really loved how that was drawn and stuff. You know, still really fun to read, but not really anything in the story is happening too much, aside from the battle just progressing. Okay. There's a lot to unpack with this, because pretty much all of chapter 4, or episode 31, is a flashback about Wilhelm's life. You get a little bit of his upbringing, you get to learn about what happened in the world before Subaru came, and you get to learn a little bit about his wife, or the who would become his wife. Now, the name Teresa, I believe, is how you pronounce it, but again, I could be wrong, because there's a lot of words and names in this series that I am not familiar with. But just for the sake of simplicity, I'll be referring to her as Teresa from now on, and then you'll have to, of course, correct me if I'm wrong on that, so that I can correct that down the road. Bunches of stuff. So Wilhem was born into a family of nobility. This isn't even in my notes. This is just what I'm remembering. He's born into a family of nobility that I believe was called, and I did write this down, the House of Trias, I don't know. I don't know the pronunciation again, right? But he ended, basically, long story short, he ends up leaving at age of 14 to go and become, I'm pretty sure, a knight is what he was going to become. He started practicing with a sword, and during all of this backstory, there is a civil war that is occurring in the country between the demi-humans and, I'm guessing, just normal humans. I don't know. They didn't really go into too much depth of this actual civil war, but it seems to be a demi-human war. And I'm guessing it was maybe between activists that wanted to protect demi-humans and their rights, and probably demi-humans that were... and then groups of people that wanted to subjugate demi-humans. I don't know. That's just my assumption on that. But throughout this war, Wilhem ended up earning a name for himself, a bit of an infamous name, Wilhem the Sword Devil. He was very brutal in his combat strategies. And he ends up meeting this girl that loves flowers, okay? And I was always asking him about what he thinks about flowers. And we kind of see, in just a short chapter, we kind of see how his character evolved over time, how he hates flowers at first. I'm surprised he didn't get smacked with hate speech for disliking flowers. But he hates flowers, and when asked time and time again, we slowly see how he evolves. You know, why does he wield the sword? Well, he comes to wield the sword to protect people. That's what he wants, right? So he wants to become a knight, or presumably. But as he gets to know this girl more and more, and as this girl gets to know him, this seemingly completely unimportant lady that we know is going to become his wife, from context that we've already been provided with, but we don't know the significance of her character yet. We end up learning when Wilhelm catches news that his homeland has been caught in this civil war, and upon returning home, finds his homeland burning. He was too late, and though we never get any confirmation that his family died, I think you're supposed to assume that his family was killed in this war. He ends up going complete berserk mode, but ultimately, he ends up getting, over the course I'm not sure if it's just his physical state or what, but he ends up getting overwhelmed and knocked on his ass, and he is going to die. Until, last second, he is saved by the Sword Saint, and it is none other than that girl that has been sitting in that flower field that he has talked to multiple times now. Upon learning this about this girl, Teresa, and the fact that she is the Sword Saint, Wilhelm, his like demeanor changes. It's almost like he's really angry at her for some reason. It's difficult, it's especially difficult in the book to ascertain his, like, if he's angry or if he's frustrated or if he's scared. I can't really tell what his behavior is in the book too much, but he's clearly aggressive about the fact that she's the Sword Saint. She ends up leaving, and I don't know the reason why she leaves. I don't know if it's because her name has now gotten out. She had been basically secretly the Sword Saint for however long, and now her name is out there, and I don't know if she's leaving so that she doesn't get all this attention. I'm not sure exactly why. They might have said that in the show, but they definitely didn't say it here in the manga. Anyways, we end up skipping forward in time when a mysterious character barges into this room with Teresa there, who is, I don't remember what she was doing there, if she was accepting some award or whatever, but this was Wilhelm, who had been presumably training for months. I think they said that it had been like two or three months had passed or whatever since she had left. And it's clear that Wilhelm had now come to duel her. He had attempted to duel her at first, but was defeated by her, and then that's when she left. And I don't know if this was ever established, but I guess, again, my assumption is that if the master swordsman or the sword saint is defeated in a duel, whoever won takes the place of the sword saint. I'm guessing that's how the rules work. Anyways, this mysterious character, who turns out to be Wilhelm, barges in and duels and overwhelms Teresa, and thus finally brings an end to her Sword Saint legacy, starting anew with Wilhelm. And the way that this whole like romance blooms, especially right at the end of the chapter, it's so cheesy, but in like the best ways possible, because maybe I'm not understanding this correctly, but the way that I interpreted all of what they said here was that once he has beaten her in a duel, he has essentially cleansed her from the responsibility of being the Sword Saint. And now, the reason he wields the sword isn't to just protect people, it's to protect you, to protect her. And I think maybe the reason why he got so angry and frustrated when he discovered that Teresa was the Sword Saint is because throughout his battles during the Civil War, the more and more he would talk with Teresa, the more he would be cautious in combat. He wouldn't be so aggressive in combat. He would be more careful to protect himself, to make sure he would fight for his brethren more than he would fight for himself. And I think that throughout all that time that had been passing, he was growing feelings for her, whether he realized that or not until much later on. So when he learned that she was a Sword Saint and has this immense amount of responsibility, he wanted to take that away from her to protect her so that the person that he loves wouldn't, you know, meet some grueling, disgusting end, right? I don't know, that's how I interpreted it. And it's really cheesy the way that he wins this duel in front of this huge group of people and says, the reason I wield the sword is to protect you. And then she said, and then we get to see a little bit of their romance bloom, and we hear her say that I love you, and she wants to hear him say it as well. And it's really cute at first when Wilhelm kind of acts, you know, sheepish, like, you know, you should know that already. Well, women like to hear it anyways. Oh, I see. Well, maybe at some point in the future, I'll tell you. And then you realize how fucking depressing it is, because once we pop back to present time and Wilhelm does bring the killing blow down on the white whale, fully avenging his wife in the process, he finally looks up at the sky and says, I love you. Confirming he never got a chance to say it to her before she passed away. And that little detail is like, oh, that is crushing right on your heart to learn that. So it wasn't just to avenge his wife. It was bringing closure to himself for basically a promise that he had made that he never got to fulfill. And you could argue he still can never fulfill that promise since she's dead. I would love to know more about Teresa as a character, because she is, you know, built up as this really powerful swordsman or swordswoman. And I don't know. I want to know how she died. Obviously, we know the white whale was the cause of her death, but how? I don't know. We were never shown that. We were never told that. Maybe we don't have to be. You know, it's just I would like to get that. I'm not saying we need to have that information. I would just like to get that information. I think that would be a lot of fun to learn about. But yeah, this whole chapter is mostly what this book is about, which is probably why the cover of the volume features Teresa and a young Wilhelm on it, because it's focused mostly on their backstory. It's also the longest chapter, I think, in the book. But that brings the chapter to a close once he has successfully killed the whale, and brings us to our final chapter of Volume 7, Chapter 5, Episode 32, The Road to the Mathers' Domain. So now we're getting ready to go back. We've successfully won. We've defeated it. Subaru takes a lot of the glory here, not purposefully. He's given the glory by characters like Krush and Wilhelm, because all of this was possible because of him. I mean, of course, everyone that lended a hand, they were crucial in actually taking down the white whale, but strategically, this could only have happened because of Subaru. So he's getting a lot of respect. And you get to see how Krush, for example, comes around and shows huge amounts of gratitude to him and shows her respect for him and explains that even if we become rivals down the road, I will never give up that respect that I have for you, which is a lot considering how kind of cold and hard she's been throughout most of the rest of the story up to this point. I said with the day one in my notes. I thought it said with the dog man. Oh, jeez. Whatever. Anyways. So everyone that we presumed had perished survived, but a few background characters did die. A lot of the soldiers and fighters had perished, and unfortunately, even though the white whale has been defeated, apparently the mist effects still remain. So those that were lost and forgotten remain that way. Krush even talks about how many casualties there were, and that we will never know who those people were that had vanished, that have now been forgotten, but we know that they basically sacrificed for this to be the victory that we got. So now we have to prepare to head back to the domain, the Mathers' domain, to protect Amelia. Obviously, the whole reason this entire thing has been happening is because of the witch's cult that is going to attack the mansion and is going to end up basically killing everybody, including the village. And Subaru has failed time and time again in order to get back there and save anybody, pretty much, including himself. So going through with this white whale plan will earn the favor of Krush. He will get fighters to join him. He will have support. And that's everything that he had basically wanted. And now we've hit that point. Now, the thing, I remember saying this when I was watching the anime for the first time, but we've gone through a really big battle. It would really suck if something bad happened and he had to reset and go through that same battle again. I know, I'm pretty sure I talked about this early on in the manga as well when I was covering the earlier volumes, but it is so just thinking about being Subaru, not even just having to deal with death over and over, but just thinking about repeating the same thing over and over, you know, and then something fails, you have to retrace your steps perfectly. That would be so exhausting. And I can only imagine what it'd be like to fight the whale again. You know, that huge, all that prep work he needed to go through, all that convincing he'd have to go through, the fight he'd have to go through again. So it would be really shitty if something happened. But it has been a little while since, well, Subaru has been re-zeroed. And so, anything's possible at this point. But in preparations for heading back to the mansion, we learn that about half of the forces that had fought with the whale will be coming back to fight the witch's cult with him. Now, he hasn't told anybody about the witch's cult yet. We remember that when he was in his desperation in a previous volume, he did try to tell Krush about the witch's cult, but all of this, you know, she had seen the hatred and the demented look in his eyes, the bloodlust and all of that, because he was obviously starting to break down mentally. But most of the rest of the people that were part of the white whale fight are wounded and they need to go back to the capital for healing. But key characters that will be joining are going to be characters like Ferris or Felix. In fact, I even wrote down Ferris and Felix in my notes. That was a mistake. It's Ferris and Wilhem is what I should have written down. So both of those characters will be coming and joining. Ricardo will be joining, and Ricardo even knows before Subaru says anything that we're going to fight the witch's cult. And he says, never underestimate the network of the Merc Band, basically. So I don't know how they got a hold of that. They must have gotten information that there's been witch cult movements somewhere near the Mathers domain up to that point. But yeah, so Ricardo had that idea, so he's coming, and then he's going to have, I believe Mimi is coming as well, the little fucker, but not Mimi's sibling, not her brother. And then, of course, we have the rest of the Merc Band coming to join as well, and they were basically guarding the road while everyone else fought the White Whale, probably to keep civilians from coming in. And we get to see them coming up the road slowly, and of course there's another notable character with them. Who? That's right, Julius. Great. And I love how it just ends with that. It just ends on Julius's face and the big smirk on his face. And then that's how Volume 7 ends, leaving you with like a sense of, oh great, here we go again. Now, mini spoilers for myself here, not myself, but anybody that's watching this should have already read. I put that in the disclaimers, okay? These are not spoiler-free, but I sometimes get ahead of myself and talk about things later on in the story if I know about them ahead of time. In this case, I know that Julius turns around as a character. I've had kind of a little bit of, you know, a poor opinion on him up to this point. I've never liked Julius. When he's introduced, he becomes a much better, much more likable character, if I remember correctly, during the rest of this arc. But your first encounters with him in the anime and in the manga, I've never liked. So that's why they end it like this. Subaru is a bit aggressive when he notices that Julius is coming, and then Julius has that just disgusting smirk on his face, like he's just so high and mighty. You know, they're still portraying him like a total douchebag, and I will continue to say that is the intention. I 100% do not disagree with, or excuse me, I do not agree with the fact that he is totally a likable character and meant to be a likable character. I think that it is 100% the artist's rendition and the writer's intent for Julius to be a douchebag when he is first introduced, so that Subaru has a reason to dislike this guy, and so that we feel like Subaru and don't like him either, so that he can have a redemption arc where he turns himself around and we get to see how useful and kind of great Julius can be, right? And I only bring this up because I got that comment in the past that said I did not understand shit about Julius and there was nothing about him being a douchebag. Bullshit. He is 100% a douchebag, and that smirk is full proof of that. Anyways. One other notable thing, though, is that Rem will not be coming back. Rem is too injured. She's exerted too much of her mana that she can't come back with Subaru, I think. I don't remember. I don't know if she's supposed to go back to the capital and heal, or she's just supposed to stay behind and rest and heal. This is the beginning of the end, okay? That's what I remember. As somebody who loves Rem as a character, and then some, I love to watch Rem in combat. She's really fun to watch. She's fun to be with. And it would be really, really shameful if we never really get to see Rem again. Except maybe, like, a couple times. But not really at her peak that we've seen up to now. That would be a big shame, wouldn't it? But we'll just have to wait and see. The last thing of the book is, of course, the afterword, which is basically just the artist kind of talking about their favorite scene, which was also the scene where they passed Krush on the land dragon, which was the scene that I said was also very badass. So they were proud of their work, and I think that they deserve to be proud of that work that they did there. But that is the end of Volume 7. Of ReZero Chapter 3, Truth of Zero. Of course, the next video that I'll be doing in the Manga Thoughts and Opinions series will be Volume 8. There are 11 volumes in total for Truth of Zero, so we're closing in on the last of it. But this is where most of my interest lies, is when they return to the mansion. It's been long enough since I saw this arc in the anime that I only remember some key moments. But I do know that this is where stuff's going to start getting very ReZero again, and I remember loving every minute of it. I think this is going to come as close as possible to A Week at the Mansion for me, which so far has been my favorite arc in the manga. But a lot of that also had to do with the artist that worked on that and the sheer brutality of the artwork. So we'll see how Daichi manages the ending of Truth of Zero when they return and fight against the witch's cult. But at least it's not just Subaru and Rem this time. We have some help. So hopefully everything will go alright, nobody gets hurt, because that would be shit. Anyways, that's it for this video. I will see you guys in the next one when it happens. Don't forget that you can always suggest new anime, manga, visual novels, etc. to me. They all get added to their respective lists, and I will get around to all of them at some point down the road with certain restrictions applying. You can always share your own opinions on Chapter 3, Truth of Zero, Volume 7 in the comments down below. But until next time, I'll see you around.